Welcome back to the Intel Extreme Masters Singapore for 2013's version. Last year, of course, we were here in Singapore, again returning once more with the Intel Extreme Masters. Fantastic to be back in what is my personal favourite country in the world, regardless of the fact that it rains a lot and is very muggy and humid. I don't know what it is about this place, but I absolutely love it. It's fantastic. The people here, by the way, are also brilliant. It's Singaporeans, you can't get any better anywhere in the world. And the crowd today, hope you're enjoying the StarCraft, everyone. See what I mean? So yeah, great to be back in Singapore. I hope we're here next year again for Intel Extreme Masters. We're deep inside Group D right now. Let's show you the bracket and how it's shaped out so far. We've had our two matches, which have already seen two of the players going through to the upper bracket final and two dropping down into the lower. As you can see, Hydra versus Hack is our next game, and at the lower bracket we'll have Squirtle versus Grubby, and that game will come up straight after this one. And Grubby on a lifeline right now, needs to win a game, otherwise he is going home very early. And remember, we only have one foreigner through so far. That one is Scarlet coming through from Group C. Our next game is ready. Let's introduce you to the players. This one's going to be a cracking game because these players are absolutely on fire right now. Please welcome to the stage our first player in our players bracket, the upper bracket of Group D. It is Hack. Of course, part of the StarTail group. He's already seen Bomber crashing out of the tournament, so he wants to make amends for that. He goes head-to-head with a team who are also on fire this week. They've sent three members over, and they're all doing very well. Thank you very much. From CJ Entus, it's Hydra. And we'll go over to our commentary team for this one. Guiding you through all the action will be Maynard and Idra.
What's up, friends? Maynard and Idra here. Welcome back to the Intel Extreme Masters. We're in the winners match for Group D, Hydra and Hack. Now, tell us a little bit about these amazing CJ players. Actually, tell us about your time in CJ.
We played a lot of StarCraft. I don't know. People always ask questions about that. It's pretty boring. We just play StarCraft all day.
It was like a 12, 13-hour practice day
roughly.
Sort of thing.
And most of the Koreans would honestly play more than that. They would play into the night. So that's why they're all so good now. Hi. The last game from Hydra was just completely impressive. He really dismantled Squirtle. And Hack, you know, we haven't seen as much from him. Actually, ZVT also from Hydra. He's known as the ZVP specialist, the ZVP sniper. I haven't seen too much of his ZVT, but just based on how good the ZVP was, you can only imagine it's going to be amazing.
Hydra's ZVT is actually his worst matchup statistically, but, These CJ players, man, I don't know what else to say. They have been tearing up this tournament so far. Can anybody stop them?
I don't know. We'll see if Hack can here. Going into the map vetoes. We were talking about this a bit earlier during one of the Scarlet matches, but a lot of the maps here, not too comfortable for ZVT. Lots of room for fast pressure from the Terran.
Hydra will probably want to get rid of Yeonsu.
That has been the first ban for most of the Zergs, yeah.
Yeah, and Hack might want to get rid of Whirlwind. We'll have to wait and see.
Whirlwind and Derelict have been the go-to TVZ bans, and then Yeonsu and anywhere... Oh, it looks like Akalon was actually Hydra's first ban.
Okay.
And so Whirlwind for Hack. So that's pretty normal thus far. You have to imagine he's going to get rid of Yeonsu now. Just every Zerg hates that map.
Yeah, you'd absolutely. In fact, his finger was near the bottom of that pad. So very, very, very likely. So yeah, Akalon wastes one of those short rush distances. Pretty good for Terran, pretty good for Protoss versus Zerg on there as well.
Well, is Polar Knight instead of Yeonsu.
So
I guess he's okay with that.
Interesting.
Polar Knight is another tough map. It's really, really possible for Terran to take their own third base very near where the Zerg wants to take their third base, and there's a very short rush distance between, so that's great for the Marine Parade kind of style. And I would expect Hack to do that. From what I know of him, he's a very like generic, basic kind of TVZ player, and that is the generic, basic go-to TVZ.
Okay.
So that would be a good map for him, so that kind of makes sense for Hydra to do there.
All right, the players have shaken hands, or shook hands, if you will, getting into the booth now, ready to start up this game. Are you having a good time in Singapore so far? I know the crowd's been getting pretty loud, been getting pretty full out there.
Yeah, there's lots more people here than yesterday. Really big, really excited crowd. The applause when Grubby came up, and especially when Scarlet actually made it her group, was just absolutely great.
Yeah, it's beautiful stuff. Mm-hmm. Red Eye doing a great job out there as always, and we're doing all right too so far.
I'd like to think so.
I've had a nice long break. Throat feels great, voice feels great, ready to scream about some StarCraft again. Pretty pumped. So Belshi will be our first map of the day.
This is a map that's been around for a long time. Either this or Whirlwind is probably the oldest map in the pool, so both these players are sure to have a ton of experience on it. Hydro so far has mostly just been a Pro League player, but Belcher was in Pro League, so certainly experienced on here. And Hack, I'm not honestly sure what Hack has been doing recently. I really just don't know too much about him. I haven't seen too many tournaments with him in recently.
Yeah, honestly, I haven't either, but you know, he showed us that he can definitely TVP pretty well, taking out the Dutch Protoss grubby there. So yeah, we'll have to wait and see. Both players are in the lobby, should be ready to go any second now. Yeah, Belcher Vestige, a map that I personally had a little bit of trouble in playing as Zerg on that map, but I found that on as Terran, I was doing a little bit better. Might be luck. I don't know if it's map balance related. I think it's actually, yeah.
It can go both ways. I would say maybe a slight Terran edge. It's really, really easy to apply pressure to the fourth base and drop the main at the same time. It's a very like two-sided kind of map. There's expansions going down one side and expansions going down the other and a good distance between them. And that's really good for Terrans to try and spread the Zerg out, especially before mutas come out or in the period where there's very few mutas. And it's hard to really shut down those medevacs too easily. So good Terrans will start applying pressure around the 11-minute mark and just keep it on from there on out, much like we saw Dream play against Scarlet in particular. Stuff like that is very difficult to deal with on here. And as I said, that's kind of the normal TVZ, the generic TVZ, and I would be pretty surprised if we saw Hack doing anything but that, honestly.
Well, like you said, he's a pretty stock standard Terran. Stock standard Terran is the bio mind push on 3cc. Do damage, you know, does he have the multitask of Dream? Can he drop in a million places at once while aggressing? Is he a super aggressive guy? Does he like to make static defense? This is all stuff that we're going to have to find out in his TVZ style. I've actually seen Hack play TVZ yet, so yeah.
Or the ZVT from Hydra. As you said, that is statistically his worst, and you always have to take statistics with a grain of salt, but...
Yeah, absolutely.
His CVP was pretty amazing statistically, and that one definitely came through for him, so...
Yeah.
Maybe there's something to it.
Sometimes they're okay. Now, again, we have to bring up the levels. Hydra rocking a solid level 4 there in Silver League. Hack, level 3. Looking like a Hydra already with that level advantage, clearly.
I think that there is no portrait there, so he's not even ranked, so... I think that's a pretty significant advantage for Hydra.
It's pretty newbie.
Yeah. Really, quite a disappointing.
Yeah, game hasn't even started yet. Already Hydra with a pretty solid lead in the mind games. Countdown has begun. All right, guys, not too long to go now. Belcher Vestige will be game number one between these heavyweights of the Korean esports scene. CJ Entis's Hydra going up against StarTail's Hack. Really hard to call. We just have so many unknown factors here with these two players. We're going to learn with you guys as this game gets underway.
Yeah, I would take Hydra just... He looked amazing in that last game. He is Zerg, a little bit of bias going. And all the CJ guys have looked so good, though, thus far this tournament.
Yeah, man. No one can stop them yet. So in the top left, can he do it, actually? Can he stop the first CJ Entis player of this tournament? This is StarTail's Hack. And in the bottom right, from CJ, this is Hydra.
Hydra's CVP was very, very... safe, most of all. He didn't even try to go for hatchery first, even when there was no probe scout on the map, even when it would have been totally safe to do so. Went with pull first into three hatch every single game. And he's always been, like, even back into Brood War, he's been very, very generic. He's not going to break any molds. He's just great execution, great decision making. He's going to take the standard template and apply it perfectly to every game, every situation he's in. So I don't think we're going to see anything too surprising from either of these players. I think we're likely to actually have a very early drone scout coming out from Hydra, so he's making sure there's no proxy rat shenanigans coming out of Hack. Again, very safe, so I guess that kind of goes in line with the ZVP play.
These players wouldn't have played each other probably for a while or at all, as far as we know, so doing a drone scout, pretty smart against a Terran that you haven't met before in a tournament, just to make sure, you know, keep him honest, look for those proxies, see what his walls consisting of, see if that fast CC is coming down there, if he's super greedy or super all in, you don't know until you look.
Yeah, I really like the early drone scout ZVT. I feel that more often than not, it's going to pay off. If there is any early cheese and you know about it immediately, hopefully you can do something to respond to it in time. If you see a fast CC, you can go three hatchery before pool even. The only thing you can't really respond to and shut down is some kind of Reaper first opening. But even that, at least you know it's coming, at least you can be prepared for it. You're not going to have to take any damage from it. And it is a CC first from Hack here, so Hydra has the option to go drop that third hatchery. He starts up a couple of drones. It is possible he's going for that.
Yeah,
I
think...
there goes the drone, so he is definitely going for it. Three hatchery, four pool.
And that's the very generic CVT response to this, to the fast CC to get that other hatchery. Not really too popular to do anything else at this stage, I think. So he's just pulling that drone back. He's got the information he needs. Barak's following this up as per usual. And Hydra, will, you know, does he want to go super greedy? Does he want to get that gas next when he gets the pool next? We'll find out pretty shortly. Still droning up.
Yeah, I personally like gas right away, because if you actually get the gas around now, you get your speedling in time to hold off the initial Hellions coming out of a normal Terran build. However, if you are going a very economical build, sometimes you just want to kind of go all the way with that, just get as many drones out as you can, delay the gas, get a little bit more mineral income, and then just rely on your queens to hold off the initial Hellions. But at that point, you're not going to have any creep spread, so I feel it's a little bit risky to rely just on the queens to defend.
Well, looks like he might have to rely on the queens to defend here, because the spawning pool has gone down, but and no gas still. Mm-hmm. So big scout there from Hack, having a good look. Hasn't seen the third yet. Overlord of Hydra in a pretty decent position here. He's going to be able to pretty much get a good idea of the gases here. Going to see when he starts mining on that natural. And
Another big thing is Hack actually made the decision to take the leftmost gas in his main, which means that the open one is actually right there next to that Overlord. So it's going to be very easy for Hydra to see when he takes that second gas, which is actually going to be right now. And that's a little bit of an indicator that, well, it's definitely going to be some kind of a fast something. Probably Cloak Banshee, maybe. But it just means it's not going to be a very fast third CC. There is going to be some kind of aggression and some kind of tech-based aggression that Hydra's going to have to deal with. And given how conscientious he was about scouting in his previous game, I'm sure that as soon as that Marine moves, and even if it doesn't, he's going to poke in and look at that and know exactly what's going on.
So much damn greed from Hydra so far. He hasn't even taken any gases yet. Still rocking gasless right now, so getting as many drones as possible, getting queens out three at a time as well, so really pumping out the mineral units. He only has two Zerglings on the map, just sort of, you know, wandering around. The rest is just, his scouting is purely overlords at the moment.
And something interesting he's doing here is using his natural queen, and an overlord is poking in to check. We'll see that starport that's coming up, and he will know. Did he see it?
He hasn't seen the starport yet.
He has not seen any of this.
No. He's actually got two overlords in a pretty good position to see this, but it doesn't look like he wants to sack either of them just yet. He really, obviously, you know, it would be beneficial. It would behoove Hydra to have a look now, because not being prepared for this will be a little bit of a thorn in the side for his opener. We can see the gas is now being taken by Hydra. Still, it's starport finishing now. We'll definitely be a Banshee opening. Meanwhile, the Hellion's heading across the map now for a bit of map control for Hack.
He's not actually bringing the starport over. He's actually getting...
He's making it look like Stim.
Ah, yes, it is a fake. He is getting concussive grenade. There's no way that's actually what he's doing.
He saw the starport.
A little bit of mind games there.
Yeah, he saw the starport, so he might actually put two and two together and realize that it does, in fact, equal four. The cancellation on that upgrade, and we will be seeing Banshee. The Hellions here just taking the towers away from Hydra for now, heading towards that third location. There are actually quite a few drones there to roast, but what's his defense looking like? He's got one queen, Spinecrawler about to finish as well. Three queens coming out now, so that's more than enough.
And the Hellions do actually just back out. They don't even run in and try and get a shot on the drones. He doesn't know that it's actually... I don't believe he knows it's a gasless opening. I don't believe he knows how late it was. So as far as he knows, Speedling could be on the way out. He doesn't want to get trapped in there with the queens by some Speedlings and lose everything. Viking comes out, and it is going to be Cloak Banshee. He has gone through with it, even though the starport got scouted. And this could mess with Hydra's mind. Even though he saw the starport, he could think it was a quick Stim, Medivac, Marine kind of attack. So it is legitimately possible that Hydra will be fooled here. We don't see any spores coming down from him just yet.
Yeah, a little bit of a... So maybe he hasn't put two and two together, actually. We'll have to wait and see. He does still have a time to put the spores down. Getting 1-1 for the ranged units of the Zerg, Carapace and ranged, will that obviously help the Queens as well as the Roaches that he's going to make, because he just put a Roach Warren down.
That is very strange. I'm not sure. Maybe he actually knows Hack better than we thought.
Oh, God.
Oh.
Oh, this Queen! She does go down. A snipe there from Hack. Uncharacteristic to really lose a queen here at this point.
Yeah, that's not something you really expect to happen. He didn't lose a Hellion for it. It didn't really even cost him anything at all. A little bit of damage. And losing those queens when you do have a Banshee coming out, very problematic, of course, because he has no spores. He's just putting up the panic spores now. Cloak is about to finish. So Hack can definitely do some damage here. No Zerglings to help deal with those Hellions.
Oh,
so
this Banshee's getting a little bit low before Cloak finishes. She's going to snipe. Oh, it does get the Banshee.
That was...
Nice snipe there for Hydra. In the meantime, these Hellions are being really annoying, but the Roaches are here to crash the party. And he's actually making so many Roaches now. He's actually getting Roach speed as well. Do you think he's just going to follow up with a big attack?
Yeah, he most definitely is. Making eight Roaches there. He hasn't quite rounded out his economy just yet. He is not saturated. This isn't, well, I don't have to make anything else. I might as well make units. He's definitely going to go for an attack here. And losing that Banshee was just a really, really sloppy mistake from Hack. No need to cut that close when you have Cloak on the way.
Yeah, it's very surprising.
And he has another Banshee out, and that does do pretty good DPS against those roaches. So maybe that will drive them back. Hydra does have the option to just charge in blindly and attack anyway and just accept the Banshee damage, but I don't think that would be wise. He's already scared Hack into building these extra two bunkers here, so I think Hydra can already chalk that up as a win. Round out his economy, maybe get some kind of additional tech. I can't imagine he's actually just going to sit on pure roaches. And
he's making 12 more.
Kind of seems like maybe he will.
Okay, 1-1 about to finish. Speed is finished, and he's making 12 more roaches, but getting a fourth hatchery as well. I would have thought after scouting those bunkers that he would have thought that it's going to be a pretty tough ask, especially considering the Banshee factor as well. Just using Cloak there for a split second, a little bit of a misclick from Hack, I believe. And yep, it's going to start wailing on the head of that morphing fourth base. Hydra, what is his plan? His plan is obviously for an attack. He's made so many roaches, it's just a waste of money, to say the least, to just have them sitting around.
Yeah, I don't really particularly like this. We got a second Banshee out from Hack. That's going to be a pretty big thorn in Hydra's side. We have Marauders already in production.
Fight.
No, this is really kind of sloppy from Hydra. This is kind of upsetting. And we see the big roach coming, a roach attack coming in. That's a lot of roaches. This could do something. He does get the Widow Mine before it manages to burrow. Takes down the bunker. Going to deny that third at least. Choosing not to charge into the natural. I don't know. I feel like he probably could have done damage there.
Yeah, I completely agree with you, man. He could have got it wrapped around those bunkers there. There's not that many units of Hack left at home. He's going to get a Spire now and a Baneling Nest, and melee upgrade. So he wants to definitely transition out of Roach, but he's already invested so much into it. There's going to have to... I feel like he's... I just don't know what he's going to do with these roaches, man. I feel like he should have just dived.
Yeah, I agree. He has not paid for... The investment he put into those roaches has not paid off, for sure. He did some damage. He scared Hack, for sure. But when you scare a Terran, they build bunkers and then salvage them later. So that's not often enough, unless it's a really significant thing. I don't know. He is just going to add in Mutiling Baneling. That does seem to be what he's transitioning into. And having roaches in that army makes it a lot beefier. It can be pretty helpful. It can make a scary army.
Well, it will be helpful very shortly because there is actually an army of Hack moving across the map. One of the Banshees getting sniped there. There's an Overseer in position, so he's actually double expanding at the same time, trying to get one on the right. Oh, I like this. Just pulling off a few roaches for an attack.
Wow.
A lot of roaches getting up in the face of Hack's attack here. Only a couple more orders, so he does have to pick up and leave. The mines did a bit of damage there, but roaches are pretty tank.
Yeah, that was just a nonsensical attack from Hack there. Roaches are really, really strong in the mid game. Hack has had his third base delayed. That's slowing down his production a lot.
Yeah.
There's just no reason to move out there. This is good. Running around in medevacs, sniping things off is good, but the frontal attack was terrible. But he's making up for it, sniping that hatchery, going into the main now. So this is much, much better from Hack.
Absolutely. So, yeah.
No speedling yet. He just realized that he hadn't actually gotten the speed upgrade ever. So it'd be kind of useless for quite some time.
Yeah,
he's going to kill the hatchery again.
Oh, wow. And no cancel again. That's 600 minerals completely wasted by Hydra.
Hydra is not looking nearly as impressive this game as his previous. And Hack, not doing anything too amazing, but just making the right decisions. Not really messing anything up too bad. And you're just going to kill hatches everywhere.
Wow. And now it's 3-base Terran versus 3-base Zerg. He's doing a great job with this harassment. This one finally gets shut down, but only after killing 3 hatcheries. And that's killing hatcheries, not, no cancel there, so...
Hack's running away. That is too many units for him to actually pick up and lift away, so he really used some there. And continued roach harass from Hydra here, but that's really not doing too much compared to the hatchery snipes that Hack is getting.
Yeah, Hydra has a supply lead right now, but I mean, that's not telling the story. Yeah, exactly. The roaches are the supply lead. He really would prefer to have those 5 hatcheries that he's been trying to get up all game. But, Hack's had something to say about that. And we got the Banelings on the way now. Mutas just getting sniped by mines in the middle of the map there. A little bit unlucky for Hydra. Some of the Mutas trying to get some harassment on this third. Getting a couple SCVs. Can't really lose any units, though. He can't really lose any Mutas. He could stand to lose some roaches, probably.
Yeah, he is very nearly max. He has the resources to max, and once it gets to that point, you want to get rid of those roaches. They are not very supply efficient once we get to this point in the game.
Yeah.
He needs to, I don't know, I would say he should just max and actually do, not an all-in, but a big full frontal assault, and just get rid of some of those roaches. They're going to trade pretty well here. He's still a pretty beefy army. Hack, he has a high supply, but it doesn't seem like he has that many units. I really think if Hydra just maxed out and went for an attack here, it would be the best idea for him.
He's going to be equal upgrades with with Hakia. Hakia already has 2-2. 2-2 is going to finish for Hydra around about when this attack appears. Oh, he's actually going to stim in here. A bit of a wrap around the Zerglings. They have speed now, thankfully, for Hydra. But there's a lot here from Hakia. He's doing a lot of damage. Hydra sort of posturing back a little bit. The Banelings now rolling in. The Marauder's taking a lot of the splash damage there. Plenty of Marines left over from Hakia. He just keeps stimming through.
He attack moved those Banelings. They just, everything detonated immediately on the Marauders. That was pretty much a total waste. And Hack still has quite a few units left. He's not going to be able to break through here. Those roaches are pretty strong against the squishy Marines.
And the Mutas are going to try and stop the medevacs as well. Sniping one, sniping two.
But the reinforcements come in, and that's going to force Hydra back. He's in trouble here.
Yeah, absolutely, man. This hatchery is in a lot of danger. Hydra
a lot
in general.
More Banelings, though.
Oh, here we go. He's going to try and get the height. Wow. Oh, wow.
That was awful.
Hack has destroyed the Banelings. The Banelings have done nothing. And Hack is...
That was a big Widowmine hit, too. That was on all the Mutas, and they just evaporated.
Wow. And you know what? Hack just reinforcing this attack. He's looking very likely to just take the game right here. Surprisingly enough, he's 30 supply up. He's stimming in. And how is Hydra going to defend this hatchery? He doesn't have enough units.
I don't think he does defend it. Hydra's just kind of crumbling here.
Wow.
Hey, GG's.
GG indeed. Hack taking a pretty convincing game one there.
Hack
away from
mad.
Hydra.
You don't go roaches against Hack.
Yeah, man. I mentioned that this guy looked a little bit like Leenok, kind of. But
Leenok's like a little ball of love. This guy, he looks angry.
The salt. The place from whence it is born. Hack's been there. And there are many roaches.
That was really disappointing compared to Hydra's ZVPs previously. I mean, maybe he's getting tired. It's kind of late in the day. He only played the one match, though. But sometimes waiting is actually even worse than playing as a player. You're sitting around waiting. That can get to you. I don't know. That just was not impressive in pretty much any way. The roaches never accomplished anything. The Muta switch was kind of what he had to do there, but he was so far behind from the roaches. The lack of cancels on the hatcheries, lack of scouting on the drops. I don't know. That was strange.
He's definitely going to need to pull his head in here if he wants to get a tied series, which is obviously what he's gunning for. So Hydra, just after a perfectly clean ZVP against Grubby, he's really, maybe just Terran rustles his jimmies. It's a possibility. It's just Hack really got inside his head there, and Hydra just didn't play his best StarCraft at all. And guarantee he plays a ZVT better than that.
Yeah, you'd have to imagine. But the upcoming map is going to be Yunsu. That's the map we were really surprised he left in the pool. The map that a lot of Zergs have been trying to avoid in ZVT. So this is not the best place for him to try and stage a comeback.
It's going to be rough just with the map balance. So what do you think is, like, if you were a Zerg and you were forced to play this map against Terran, would you pull something crazy or would just play standard?
I think the best approach to it is basically the way Scarlet was playing every ZVT earlier. You just get a couple extra queens out, you get your gases before you go ahead and take your third. You secure yourself a bit more and then take a safer third. I really feel like that's the best approach. There is no good two-base ZVT. You can do a Roachbane all-in. That's pretty risky but powerful. It can work, but it is just straight out of cheese. Mm-hmm. There's no macro roach builds that you should actually go against bio play. And you, obviously, two-base Muta is just... It can work. It can set you up for other things, but it's a pretty big risk. And if your opponent figures it out, then you're going to be in trouble. So I would just recommend a safer third into a Mutaling Baneling kind of thing.
Looking at Scarlet when you're thinking about ZVT, never a bad idea. Doing a great job against Bomb. I can't wait to see your games tomorrow in the championship bracket. It's going to be good. Going to be good.
That it will.
All right, so we've got Hydra on screen there. Really needs to pull his head in. He's got to get Hack to fall here on a very tough map for Zerg. Big ask, but let's get into it. Stranger things have happened. In the top right here, from Team StarTail, this is Hack. And in the bottom left here, from CJ Entis, this is Hydra.
Hydra needs to start his comeback by not making any roaches. I really just don't understand that decision last game. Mid-game roaches, especially against Banshees, you either got to all in pretty early. Like, there's some cute builds you can do. You can, like, make some extra queens, pop down a Nidus, and then roach queen all in. And if that's a surprise, that can actually be an incredibly powerful cheese. But there was nothing like that. It was just straight make roaches and then hope the Banshees don't attack them or something. And that doesn't seem like the best plan to me. So I really don't know what he was thinking there.
Well, you know, I was watching that game and I was like, 6 roaches? Sure.
Yeah.
8 roaches? Yeah, okay. But then, you know, then another 14 got made behind that. And I was like, well, okay.
Maybe a bit overzealous there.
Yeah.
Even making the roaches defensive, I'm not a big fan of, but at least it makes sense. that means you can get gas later, you can get more queens out earlier, you don't have to worry about getting speedling up.
You don't have to worry about Hellions either. Well, generally. Hellions can still get past roaches, but...
If you're careful, you don't have to worry about it too much.
That's right. So Hack going to go for not the extreme greed that he did in the last game. This map is quite a bit smaller. Going to go for maybe Gasless Expand here by the looks of it.
Maybe. It is still early enough, he can drop a refinery.
Yep.
I would say Reaper is probably the more likely, but that's just because I think Reaper is the better build.
Okay.
He is getting kind of late to drop a gas, so maybe it will be Barrack CC. Maybe he does like the very economically focused game, but he just doesn't feel safe enough going CC first on such a small map.
Mm. So yeah, definitely too late for that gas now.
Yes, it is.
All right. So yeah, just pure mineral opening here from Hack. Hydra going for a scout now, getting the gas before pull after taking the hatchery.
But he will be going for speedling this game.
Yeah, it will go well for him to have speedlings this time.
Yeah,
He definitely forgot that upgrade in the last game. Well, you know, along with the many other things that Hydra did a little bit suspectly. Getting up here with the Overlord though, a lot more stock standard so far from both players. Well, actually, we don't really see the gasless. Hasn't seen this gasless expand too often. I think we saw it one time from Bomber.
Yeah, Bomber seems to quite like it. I'm not really sure why. I discussed earlier how I really don't like it. It feels like a very middle-of-the-road build. Doesn't have the economy of 14cc. Doesn't have the map presence of a Reaper expansion. And really, 14cc, if you do it properly, is absolutely safe. If you build it in your wall-in, and you know the proper additional building placements to block out a 6-pool or anything like that, there's nothing that can actually kill it. So I see no reason to do Rack CC instead of 14cc. It does sometimes set up follow-up attacks, like the Marine Rush that Bomber did to Scarlet that one game on Polar Night. But we see a very early double gas from Hack, so...
Wow.
We'll see if this leads to anything special or if he's just going for those Hellions quite early to get that map control.
Normally you get those double gas after you make some barracks, so, yeah.
This was a build that was a little bit more popular a while ago. Go that Barrack CC, even back in Wings of Liberty, I think. Go double, Barrack CC, then get your double gas in order to get your tech up without too much delay, because if you start the one gas, it actually takes a long time to accumulate enough to get that factory down.
He probably wants Banshee again, just judging by the trend of TVZ these days. The SCV getting in here does get a good look, sees the gas as well, with one drone still in it.
Interesting, that one drone, because the standard is to just take all of your drones off once you get 100 gas. That could be just a small mistake by Hydra, or he could be aiming for something like a Roche Bane Rush. This is a pretty decent map for it. It's a relatively wide choke, and it is a very short rush distance. So maybe that, but more likely just a mistake.
Maybe Yondu is in this map because Hydra has something really crazy planned
for
it.
That is true. Most players have Bandit. He chose not to. That could be indicative of that.
Mm. Well, you know, with this build, you do get those bunkers up because you have plenty of minerals. Got the Lings coming in here. That's a pretty nice bunker placement, especially with that supply depot as well. Gonna make it pretty, this natural is gonna be pretty ling proof, and so is that ramp as well. Oh, except for that little spot where that one ling was. You saw the factory, saw the reactor there as well, so you could pretty much not scout and expect Hellions, but it's good to know, the more you know.
Yep, I think we've only seen one TVZ thus far this tournament that didn't open up with reactor Hellions, but in that one case, you gotta be aware of it, otherwise you're gonna die. And it actually turns out to be a double factory build. Looking like two factory blue Hellion with that tech lab coming up right next to the second factory. So not in fact Banshee, but something even a little bit cheesier.
Yeah.
But this is also, I'd say this is probably the third most common opening, like super generic, then Banshee. Then we've actually seen a lot of this two pack blue flame Hellion build, both from Bomber and Happy.
That's what I was about to say. Bomber pulled it out against Scarlet. Happy pulling it out as well. So yeah, there's the blue flame starting, correctly analyzed there by Idra. We got two Evo Chambers going down. So he is setting up a bit of an anti-Hellion wall there at the natural, the Zerg is, but he's trying to get up a third. And by the time this blue flame Hellion finishes, or by the time the blue flame upgrade finishes and there's Hellions on the map, this third will probably be probably have drones at it. Nice juicy drones for those Hellions. Overlord getting in here for a scout. Does it see what it needs to see? It just sees the barracks with the tech lab. Nothing to see there at all. So it doesn't glean what he needs to see.
And Hack is actually starting Stim and adding two additional barracks, so this is not just a pressure blue Hellion while going into a third base like we have seen before. This is going to be a pretty hardcore all-in. He's going to maybe harass with the blue Hellions, maybe just save it up and wait for his bio to accumulate and do a really, really big mid-game timing attack. But one way or the other, it's going to be very powerful if Hydra's not ready for it.
Yeah, man. It's going to be dangerous. So Hydra probably will need to sack another overlord, but he doesn't have any position to be able to see the main here, so he's going to have to react as soon as possible when he sees it going across the map. He does have the watchtowers at least, well, except for this bottom one. He does have the one near Hack's main, but Hack will probably just head south through his third location, so just the general attack path with you when you have the Hellions. Just going to take out these rocks.
A roach and a baneling nest coming down from Hydra, and this, given his style, given that he went roaches last game, this may just be because he wants to go roaches and banelings, which, you know, it's unusual, but I mean, some players do like that kind of style. Or maybe he got some kind of sniff of this, and that's going to be a really strong defensive force. Assuming he produces at the right time, and it does look like he's starting up unit production, he's going to be able to hold this attack off very, very easily. But here come the Blue Hellions. He only has a bunch of links.
Oh, the Hydra's are actually just going to bust. Sorry, the Hellion's going to almost bust through here. Hydra in a little bit of trouble. They do push through the natural. A couple of them get taken out on the way through. There's still plenty, though, to do a lot of damage. Four Hellions with Blue Flame. Nothing to sneeze at. These Lings are trying to get them taken out. There's a Stutter Step here. Looking like the Hellion on the left is going to be sniped. The drones, he sees the Spire, but it looks like a pretty good hold from Hydra here.
Really, really questionable control from Hack outside the natural there. He could have just ran through the little gap.
Yeah, he might have been
in perfect position. Instead, he actually gave Hydra this round. But here we have the secondary follow-up attack and the SCV train, so this is going to be an all-in from Hack.
Oh yeah, choo-choo, here comes the train. We got a lot of Blue Flame Hellions getting caught by Hydra. Nice catch!
And that's really big, because all he has is Zerglings. So if the Hellions are with the main army, there's nothing Hydra can do. And he's not morphing any Banelings. He really, really needs Banelings.
Yeah, 17 on the way now. 28 more Lings being made. He is in the natural, barreling through. These Queens are delaying the inevitable. They do bust through. Will these Banelings be done in time? I think they will.
Yeah,
the Marauders are trying to get here to take them out, but it's looking like Hydra might just have enough here to pull this out. The drone's being pulled. Couple of Blue Flame Hellions left, but I think this might be too much from Hydra here. Yeah, he's going to demolish this.
He's absolutely destroyed that. Losing the Hellions was the end of that, and Hydra laughs at that silly little build that Hack did and goes on to game three.
All right, so Hydra fixing his style a little bit, getting that Tide series that he wants in. You know, going to get into game number three here. Will he be able to tie off to finish off the series with a 2-1? So definitely dealt with Hack there. Didn't even need to scout the main, just got a whiff of it somehow. Like you said, he made those correct tech structures as soon as he needed to, without actually getting in there. He didn't see the factory. He didn't see the, he didn't see Blue Flame Hellions until they were in his natural, you know, killing his queens and all his Lings, so.
He was making a big round of Lings. It feels like he knows something was up, but he wasn't making roaches. And if you know Blue Flame Hellions are coming and you have the Roach Horn, you make roaches. So I don't think he knew exactly what was up. I think his spider senses were tingling. And so he made some units. But really, that came down to Hack's control. Hack had enough Blue Flame Hellions that he could have gotten in position and could have roasted all those Lings. But I don't know. Really weird little misstep from him backing up into that corner, because he could have done a lot of damage there. I don't know if it would have won him the game, because that follow-up attack still was just relatively quite weak compared to what Hydra had. So that may not have actually been game-deciding by any means, but it definitely would have given it a chance.
Yeah, also Hydra catching those Hellions in the follow-up attack as well is pretty huge, considering, you know, he took out like six of them, so great catch there from Hydra. So Frost will be our final game, final battle between these two heavyweights. Hack contemplating, looking like he's just trying to get concentrating here, or he's picking his nails.
One way or the other.
Yeah.
Either way, important to good play.
Well, it's important to have clean fingers. I know that if I ever look at the keyboard, which I rarely ever do, and I see dirty nails, I'm pretty
upset.
Just
don't want to be disgusted. That would distract you from the game.
I would have to please pause, and I'll find something firm to get that dirt out of there. All right, so Frost is loading up now. Hydra really looking a little bit better in that second game. I think he might need to step it up, though, if Hack wants to do something a little bit more standard. So anyway, let's introduce the players. In the bottom right here from StarTail, this is Hack. And in the top right, from CJ Entis, this is Hydra.
And Frost is a bigger map, much bigger map than the previous two maps we've had. Belshire, of course, kind of in between, but still a relatively short rush distance. Frost is very big and very long. And it's going to be hard for Hack to get to Hydra in the mid-game. And for most Zerg players, that would be a very good thing. You want to have some space and get your double upgrades going and really just get that big Mutaling Bane ball on the move. But Hydra, he seems to like roaches. And big maps are not good for roaches. You really need to be able to apply pressure and scare your opponent in the mid-game if you are going to go any kind of roach-centric play. So I mean, Hydra, he's a high-level programmer. He's completely capable of playing Mutiling, Baneling. There's no way that he's going to have to go Roaches to win. But if that is out of his comfort zone, if ZVT is his weakest matchup, he's maybe less flexible in it. That could be a problem for him. But I really hope... Oh, we're actually seeing Barracks first from Hack.
Okay.
Well, this has been more of a 14cc map. It's a big four-player map that tends to spell 14cc for Terrans.
But hey, you're right, man.
Playing more aggressive.
Yeah, got to get the Reaper opening. Wow. So, I mean, with the Reaper opening is kind of weird because you don't actually know where your opponent is yet. So, you know, the Reaper could get there. You know, if you're really unlucky, it gets there last. And all of a sudden, there's all these Queens and Zerglings, and you just, you know, you don't get any information at all.
Yeah. There's a small, an outside possibility that he goes one base Reactor Hellion. That is the other possible opening that involves an early gas for
possibly,
Terran.
Yeah.
But that's not also a particularly good build, in my opinion. It's pretty easy to shut down, pretty easy to keep from doing any damage. And if it doesn't do damage, you end up behind. And so here we see... Let's start the Reaper, so it will be that. He's not STV scouting, so he kind of just gets to hope.
Well,
you're definitely not going to do any damage. This Reaper's solely going to be to delay the third base of Hydra.
Yeah, so it might work out for Hack after all, going for an STV scout now, heading out towards the middle of the map. And the Overlord in the heading in the correct position for Hydra, but it was his second Overlord, unfortunately, so it'll get him a little bit late. So the SCV just looking over to the left in correct position, but, you know, the players will find each other. Reaper popping out now for Hack, going in the incorrect position. Second Reaper as well. Okay, so two Reapers. Oh, no, that's the first Reaper. Second one is on the way, though.
Second one on the way, so seems like a normal opening. You have to expect to see a command center coming down here soon. And Hydra opening up with Speedling, normal from him as well. And he does pull the drones off of gas in order to, or as soon as he gets 100 gas for speed. So looking very standard from both players. A little bit non-standard for such a big macro-oriented map, but normal-ish builds anyway.
Yeah, you would obviously expect 14cc and probably 3 hatch before pull on this map from both players. But they're doing their style. They're probably better at StarCraft than we are. Definitely better than me, at least. And this Reaper did manage to get into that natural. He's actually going to kill a couple links here.
Yeah, he is. That queen. The queen pops out there. It seems a little bit late, but no big deal. Losing those links. The links are only there to hold off the...
I was just saying, a second Reaper as well. It's a little bit aggressive here from Hack.
Yeah, he's had decent map control. He knows that the Zerglings haven't snuck out. And the big reason you keep one of the Reapers back home is just to make sure that a couple of Slowlings don't get around and kill your SCV building command center. So if he feels confident that no Zerglings got out, no reason not to have that second Reaper there and try and do some damage. And a very early third CC, so much more normal style from Hack here.
Obviously, because he made two Reapers, that Overlord's going to have free reign to scout in the main here.
Marines are coming out, so it will end up dying here, but it's going to get some good information. It might just escape, I'm not sure. But it does get some good information. It sees that third command center. That's all Hydra needs to see to know that he's safe to put down a third hatchery and go into macro mode.
Yeah, Overlord is in trouble. Two Marines is more than enough to spell its doom. Hack is going to be getting that tech lab down. So what is Hack's plan here? Looking like he might want to... Yeah, going to go Banshee again. Switching it over, going to get the Hellions as well. The Hellion Reaper follow-up, very, very standard in TVZ. Going to go for a little bit of poke, do some damage at that third. Going to have a Banshee with it as well, by the looks of things.
Yeah, that could be... If Hydra underestimates it, because he saw that third command center and he feels like it's going to be more of a macro-oriented game, it could do some damage. It's obviously going to be quite late, but he did play those mind games. Not even mind games, it's just he's opening up with a more macro-oriented build and then transitioning into harass, which might be unexpected, so it might end up doing some damage, even though it's not quite as efficient. But Hydra looks like he's teching up quite quickly, and he actually has a Roach Warren coming. We kind of missed that until a little bit late, but he has a Roach Warren finished now. And is he going to just make a bunch of Roaches? Yeah, it kind of looks like he is.
Six Roaches on the way, so he does need Roaches to win after all. He's made them every game.
This is really weird, and a Baneling Nest coming, so it's going to be a Roachling Bane. He has a third hatchery, so it's not 100% all in, but very aggressive Roachling Baneling play. He's going to have a Banshee out, though. And Banshee, back in Wings of Liberty, Banshee was the reason you didn't really go Roach Baneling too much. And in Wings, Banshee was in Heart of the Swarm, Banshee was less popular, so now Roachling Baneling has made a big comeback. But here, this game, he is going to be dealing with the Banshee.
Okay, so he's heading into that third as expected. Doing some damage on this Queen here. Might actually get her. Roaches coming up here to have something to say about that, though. There's a ton of Roaches. Wow.
I don't know why he pulled his Roaches back. That cost him so much time. It exposed what he's doing. Hack is going to be really prepared. Now we see two more bunkers already going up for the natural. I really don't know why Hydra pulled all of his roaches back to try and deal with two Hellions.
Hydra may actually not be that comfortable in ZVT. He's done some pretty aggressive stuff in all the games we've seen here. Well, it worked out for him in game 2 because there was an ult incoming, but in game 1 and 3, it's looking a little bit like Hax, a lot more prepared. Get the SCVs here. All the bunkers aren't done yet, but there is a Banshee shooting their heads.
He's running his Zerglings back. He's just given up on this attack. He's just going to sap the roaches and try and go into macro mode from here. This is kind of horrendous.
So the roaches will die for nothing. Well, they actually pushed away the Hellions at least. The Zerglings are back on home creep, getting a lair behind this. Double Evo and droning. So trying to get into Ling Bane Muta after a failed roach aggression.
So not the most comfortable place to be in for a Zerg player. His upgrades are quite late. His drone count is pretty weak. No macro hatch anywhere soon. He doesn't have a ton of extra queens, although his creep spread is not bad. That is one thing he does have going for him.
Yeah,
quite. But I don't think he has any additional queens, in fact. Ooh. A nice surround on the Hellions, though. That at least... he's going to get... Might kill off all of them. So that's a nice big win for Hydra there after a pretty sloppy opening. That Banshee is out. Does he have Cloak? He does have Cloak. So he's going to need some Spore Crawlers. Two Banshees with Cloak, yeah. But he has the Spores calling down, coming down all the mineral lines, and his Lair is finished. So he can get an Overseer, some mobile detection if he needs it.
Mm-hmm. Hydra recovering here. Starting to look a little bit more stable. Baneling Nest going down as well.
He already has a Baneling Nest, though, so maybe not so stable.
Oh. Yep, second Baneling Nest. The new meta. We've got some queens here, just going to... Oh, he's actually going to get that one Banshee. Get sniped there.
He almost killed two queens for free, but just at the edge of the queens range there. He will kill three queens for one Banshee, though. You know, that's a very good trade for Hack.
Yeah, absolutely. And the Spore Crawler could actually be borrowed to move up there to get him some gas, but he's going to leave it there for now.
And losing more and more drones. Hydra just looks so incredibly uncomfortable these games.
Yeah.
Very strange.
I'm getting the impression he doesn't like ZVT too much.
Not at all. He's getting roach speed. God damn it. I guess, well, the fact that he put down that Baneling Nest, I imagine he's going to go for like a Speed Roach, Speed Bane all in, something like that.
With Banshees already on the map with Cloak, though.
He did kill off both the Banshees, and there's no more in production. There's no way for him to know that, but I guess he's just kind of gambling on it, and the gamble will pay off here. So it might end up working out, but it's really weird play. It's just so strange to see someone who had such a good ZVP look so lost in ZVT. Especially like an accomplished big time pro gamer. It shouldn't be like this. But anyway, he is going to do a powerful all in. Now he has a Spire coming up, so maybe he's not doing an all in. He seems undecided, so it makes it really hard for us to figure out what he's doing.
Yeah, it's a little bit indecisive. He actually started an upgrade there and canceled it. Looked like he accidentally researched Overlord drop and then canceled it and made Overlord speed instead. And 10 more roaches.
Why not?
Why not? Let's make everything.
So this should be a Roachling Baneling all in once the speed upgrades for both the Roaches and the Banelings finish. But he's not really committing to the unit production. He has the 4th Hatchery coming up. He has the Spire coming up. He just doesn't have that many units. But there comes a Brig Swell, so I imagine he's going to attack here. But most of the other things he's done haven't made the most sense, so... may or may not happen.
It's looking like his plan is to try and put some big hurt onto Hack and maybe catch an army out of position, try and crush an army and get a bit of a supply lead and then gear up that feel safe about his 4th maybe.
Yeah, Hack is walking out into the middle of the map with a less than gigantic army. So if Roachling Bane engages this, it will destroy it. It's just going to be whether or not he can lift up into those medevacs and run away before he dies. And Hydra is actually just going to go over a counterattack. And I kind of like this. He can trade a 4th hatchery for a 3rd base and be just fine.
Yeah, this orbital's very naked. There's a bunker there with two Marines in it. That's not going to stop this. I think we will think everyone agrees. Oh, wow. Yeah, tons of dead workers here. 16 killed by Hydra so far. So, yeah, absolutely. The hatchery does go down. Some drones that are being transferred go down as well. What a contaminated flying CC. Haven't seen that before.
And Hydra runs back to defend. I like that choice. He's not going to bust into the natural. It would be really risky to try and do so. And he has the units to contest this, to save that 3rd base. He just has to make sure he takes a good engagement. Watch out for the Widow Mines.
And here we go. The Widow Mines are, in fact, shooting. Not very good connections on the mines just yet. There are quite a few left, but they hit the Overlord instead. Mutas in the main, trying to get rid of this drop. It's looking like Hydra's actually defending okay so far. Losing some Mutas, though. Comes some links on the low ground. Yeah, he will clean this up. The boosted medevacs will probably get out of there. There's not a very high muta count here, so they won't be able to DPS it down. But actually, yeah, he will catch this because the Ling's on the ground. The drop is deflected, so these medevacs will need to go home with their tails between their legs. Looks like he's starting to get the defense at that 3rd now. After losing a ton of workers, Hack down to 56 versus the 80 drones of Hydra.
Yeah, Hydra really took the better end of that trade, trading a naked hatchery and then a few drones at the third base for the almost the entirety of the SCV line at the third base, as well as forcing a lift up. Ooh, nice Widow Mines. Yeah, those two that remained after the Overseer's four Hydra died, Hack really making the most of them. But Hydra does see it. He should clear it up after this. And Hydra actually dropping a fourth right in the middle of the map, right next to Hack's third. So that's... Oh wow.
Wow. Great run by Witch Bane.
29 killed.
Holy
now.
Hell. Dang.
So, and that leaves the worker count at 43 for Hack to 80 for Hydra. So he has double his worker count. And he has a very mid-game army. He's not dying to an all-in or anything. Nine. Which means Hack is going to have a very hard time pulling back into this.
Yeah. He's still got a ton of roaches as well with upgrades.
Those roaches actually help him quite a bit here, because when you kill that much economy, or when you lose that much economy, loses three or four mutas for free, so that's not the best, but still pretty okay. But when you lose that much economy as a Terran player, you want to be looking for attacks to kind of try and equalize. Roaches, you don't want to attack into roaches. It's just not a good idea. So the roaches here for Hydra, quite good, as long as Hack gets aggressive here.
And Hack stimming in. Oh, not stimming in. He's actually stimming away, just A-moving in, looking like he doesn't want to pick that fight. Getting back to deal with some Lings at the third here. This entire Ball of Marines has been stemmed, though. So
and not very many medevacs to help heal that up.
Just actually one
only
of them's leaving.
Two. Yeah. So. Hydra really could use some creep spread over in this area here. He has good creep spread down the middle, but it's very, very single-minded.
He's so aggressive. Like, this is an extremely aggressive
fight. The medevac died for free.
Oh, very nice pickup there from Hydra. Pack going straight into a cloud of mutas. And there's some Widow Mines here, but it looks like the bending connections are pretty good so far. He's actually demolishing this attack from Hack.
Yeah, that Roachling Baneling army is just so, so strong in the early mid game before you hit to a max. And, big drop up to the top.
Yeah,
the mutas will clean that up pretty easily. And just so many units still alive for Hydra here. Hack just doesn't have anything left.
Yeah, Hack's been actually decimated by this army. The third has to be given up again, the worker supply. Still, it's slightly better for Hack, oddly enough, than it was before, but it's still pretty dismal compared to what Hydra's is like. The third is lifted. It's not going to come down anytime soon. Muta's going to just clean up the drop that's on the other side of the map in Hydraville, and Hydra's just going to pull back.
And Hydra's still on a comfortable 3-4 base economy. His drone account is pretty much untouched. A little bit harassed by Hack, but nothing too effective, and more Banelings coming. Hydra is not going to let the pressure off. He's not looking, he has a Hive coming up, but he's not looking to go to late game. He is just going to keep the pressure on this third base, prevent Hack from ever getting any kind of decent army up.
Yep, 20 more Lings on the way, plus 3 on the way for the bio of Hack. He's starting to get Marauders as well, so.
Marauders would have been smart if he initially recognized the Roaches, just sat back, waited. You add Marauders in, you get to a maxed army, and then you just destroy the Roaches. But as is, it's too little, too late.
Yeah, it's just too much Zerg here. It is rolling straight through this third again, lifted for probably the sixth time this game, and this Baneling train probably going to destroy what's left of Hack's army. He's splitting valiantly, but this might just be too much Zerg. In fact, it is just too much Zerg. He doesn't have enough units. GG! Hydra taking a weird series with a 2-1.
Not the prettiest games there. Not as clean as his ZVP win over Squirtle, but he got it done. He got through. He takes the first place in Group D and advances to the round 8 already.
That's right. So he will go on to the championship bracket, going to have a night to sleep on it, get his head into the right place, and, because he likely might have to play Terrans again. So.
Yeah. And he joins the other two. Actually, is MVP the only Terran player who has made it through so far?
I believe so.
I think he is. And MVP plays mech, so those roaches will actually kind of come in handy there.
And there you go.
So Hydra's looking pretty good for this tournament. And actually, all three CJ players looking good. All three of them made it through to the round 8.
It was kind of looking for a little while there that Hydra was going to be the first CJ Entis player to fall, I guess. But his teammates are looking extremely strong. Effort, the teammates in Effort and Hero, for anyone that was wondering. So there we go. The series is complete. And such a weird game.
I know. I just can't wrap my head around it. Anyone who likes Roach's ZVT is a little bit weird to me, but he made it work. And against Hack, it may just be a stylistic thing. Hack was clearly very aggressive. He was attacking no matter what. And Roaches are pretty good against that kind of thing. Roaches' mid-game fights, they are king. They are almost as efficient as Banelings without the risk, without the suicidal part of the unit. So if you know your opponent is going to take attacks no matter what and not really think it through, like we saw Hack do, the Roaches actually kind of pay off. If you can fight before you hit to a max army, then they're not the worst thing in the world. the first game, they were the worst thing in the world. When making them against the Banshees and then like running around the middle of the map and not engaging, that was just pretty terrible. But the third game, yeah, it worked out pretty well for him.
It's actually a little bit of miscontrol from both players there. I mean, they sort of like had a bit of a shaky, weird opening, but then got sort of in the groove. But at the beginning of the game, they definitely felt a little bit jittery, like just a few miscontrols, kind of, you know, they are human.
It's strange, though, because it's a winner's match. They're both coming off wins. They should be warmed up. They should be pretty confident, even. Although, I guess you're playing to advance to the round of eight. Maybe that gets in your head. I don't know. It's just strange in general to me.
It's actually not too common for, especially a Kesper player, to get nervous or, yeah, you know, those nerves on stage.
Well, you say that, but, I mean, it's still up on stage. You're still playing for a lot of money, a lot of titles. You know, yeah, this is their life. That can always get to you.
Mm. All right, well, looks like we're going to have an interview on stage with Hydra. I'm going to cross over to Paul now.
Thanks very much, Maynard. Yes, great commentary again from Maynard and Israel there. Well done, congratulations. Fantastic game in the end. Let's start at map one, though, because map one didn't go your way. Can you explain why?
일단 축하드리고요. 첫 번째 맵을 얘기한다면 좀 잘 안 풀린 것 같았었는데 왜 그랬는지 저 정확히 설명해 줄 수 있나요?
일단 연습할 공간이 마땅치 않아서 좀 연습을 못 하다 보니까 첫 판 할 때 손이 좀 안 풀렸었어요. 그래가지고 두 번째 판부터 다행히 손이 좀 풀리면서 제가 원하는 대로 게임할 수 있었던 것 같아요.
Well, in the first game I was not really warmed up. I couldn't really practice here that much. So, but after that it was better.
Yeah, it was much better. Second map was really strong, and then third map you just destroyed him. Did you look at his builds beforehand and then come in knowing exactly how you were going to play against him?
그럼 첫 번째 게임 끝나고 이제 다음 게임들은 훨씬 더 잘한 것 같았었는데 네. 정확히 상대가 뭐를 할지 알고 빌드를 짜가지고 준비해서 왔었는지.
아니 딱히 빌드를 상대에 맞춰서 준비해 온 건 아니고 그냥. 그때 맞춰서 가려고 했는데 두 번째 판부터는 제가 생각했던 대로 잘 된 것 같아요.
No, actually, I didn't really plan like a special build orders for him. I just played my games and it pretty much worked out.
Yeah, it definitely worked out for you. What is it about CJ Entis? You guys look very good this week. All of you have played some fantastic StarCraft 2, and we don't see you enough. We see you in Pro League, but we don't see you come to these big events like Intel Extreme Masters. What is it about this event that you're all doing so well? You had lots of practice together this week?
CJ Entis 소속 선수들이 여기 와가지고 엄청 좋은 성적을 보여주고 있는데 다른 대회나 이렇게 CJ Entis를 볼 기회가 많이 없는데 해외 팬들은 왜 그런지 그리고 또 성적을 어떻게 이렇게 잘 냈는지 한번 설명해 주세요.
글쎄 저희는 일단 그 캐스파 소속으로 돼 있어가지고 프로리그에 집중하다 보니까 해외 대회 많이 못 나왔는데 저희 팀 같은 경우는 앞으로 해외 대회 많이 보내준다고 팀에서 약속을 했거든요. 그래가지고 앞으로 더 많이 나오면서 더 좋은 경기 많이 보여드릴 수 있을 것 같습니다.
Yeah, since we are a team playing for Casper, we didn't have really a lot of chances to go out and play foreign tournaments because especially we have to focus on Pro League. But CJ Entis, our team, promised us to send us more in the next year, so look out for it.
Okay, great. Well, I think I speak on behalf of everyone in StarCraft. It's fantastic to have you here. It's great to have CJ Entis as part of the tournament. We hope that we see you more next year as well. But you're still in the tournament now. You're through to the quarterfinals. Is there a player in the quarterfinals that you would like to play or someone that you would like to avoid?
그럼 다음 라운드에서 만나고 싶은 선수가 있는지 아니면 만나기 싫은 선수가 있나요?
딱히 만나고 싶은 선수도 만나기 싫은 선수도 없는데 그냥 저희 팀원이 세 명이다 보니까 저희 팀원은 최대한 피해서 올라갔으면 좋겠어요.
I can't really think of anyone who I would rather face or not, but I really don't want to face my teammates in the next round because we are three here at IEM, so.
I figured that might be the case. Ladies and gentlemen, we do have a seventh member of the quarterfinals. CJ Entis have yet another player. Three of them have made the quarterfinals, so congratulations to Hydra. Hack, unfortunately, going down to the lower bracket, will get a second chance, though. And we'll have his match coming up a little bit later on. Next up, though, it's Squirtle versus Grubby. Last chance saloon for both men. We'll be back in a bit.